Anton, I think you're going to kick off on this one.
Yeah. So, okay, we're going to go on after from the HTML5 screens. We're going to go into core software now. Obviously, in the last year, we haven't only been developing the HTML5 front ends and so on. We've also done quite a few nice little enhancements into the software. We're not going to spend a lot of time on this, but we do want to just talk through what these new functions do, so that you're aware of them. And that's obviously shop standard with the later versions of the software. So we'll go through them. I'm not going to go through that list now. We'll go through them one by one. But perhaps, Stephen, if you want to just do the current scanner field one, then we can go from there.
Right, okay, so the first one, a lot of your IT guys have probably come up with it. He comes up with a screen and he says, well, in this case, it's the put away consolidation. And the guy's so frustrated because if you look at the screen, you can see that the description there is cut off. And also he says, well, we're not log traceable, so why do we need to see this information? So a simple problem, but what we've done is we've implemented something in the software, and this is in obviously the legacy scanner, to allow you to customize the grids or the list views on those screens, however you see fit. So what you can do is you can make the fields a bit bigger and make them a bit smaller. So this is just a simple example, which I'm going to show you on our scanner here. So what I've got is I've got a scanner emulator running here. So I'm just going to get rid of my presentation. Okay, so what I'm going to do is log into the standard scanner application here. So I think I logged myself out earlier. I might have to open up WMS again. Got to get used to all the way of doing things.
Steven, if you want, I can jump in and do the next one and come back to this one. And this is quick.
Yeah, let's give it a shot now. It should be okay. I think it's because I had it open for so long. Yeah, I think Anton, you go for it.
Okay, so I'll just share my screen quickly, if you can just give me a secy. Right, so I'll just talk quickly through the advanced bin maintenance. So basically what we did is the current software that you use to, we have a creation of new bin locations. It works quite fine when you're kind of doing basic ranges and so on. Where the limitations were is if you wanted to do mass imports of bins or mass updates on bin data. So that's what the screen has essentially been designed for. I'll go into the software and just give you a bit of a view on how it works. Starting with just where it is in the menu, there's bin maintenance. You guys are quite used to the screen. I'm going to open in a second or two. So that still remains, but we've created this new one over here that allows us to import bins and do bulk updates on bins. So I'm going to show the import function first. This is obviously particularly neat for brand new sites or an existing site that wants to open a new warehouse, and you have existing bin locations in there. So essentially what I can do is I can just go and fetch a single bin, okay, just to create an export file from which I can then sort of work with. So what I've done here is I've pulled into the grid just a single bin. I'm going to use our standard functionality to pop that out into Excel. So I'll call this file, let's say bins2 XML, XLS. If Okay, that exported a little file. So that's normal sort of data functionality, right? Let me just go and get it. This is bins 2, that's the one there. Okay, so if I open it up, there's the data obviously into Excel. So I can take this data like this and I can copy it down, right? And I can give my own bin location number. So let's say I'm going to do them as 83. Okay, so I've got a new range of bins, and I mean, however you want to do these bins is completely up to you as to what you put in there. Okay, the rest of the settings I want to keep the same. So I want the same area, I want the same zone. They're going to be part of the same zone. Maybe I don't want two pallets per bin. Maybe I only want one. So just update that quickly. Then there's a thing called a check digit. I can update the check digit behind the scenes. And make a different check digit. And just a little bit of background on the check digit, that's only needed if you're using the voice module. Then it prints a little check digit on your bin label, and when the guy picking with a voice headset comes to that particular bin, the way we confirm he's at the right bin is he reads that check digit back. Okay, so cool. So I've created some additional bins. Obviously this could be one massive spreadsheet. I'm just doing a small one for now. I'm gonna save that. Okay. If I go back into the software, I just need to move a few things around here. I go back into the software, I can go into the import function, browse for a file. Okay. I want to see all files. Where's my bin 2 here? And I open that. There's the data immediately pulled into the software. Okay, so that's the data I've just created in the spreadsheet. I can then click the update button. What that does is it validates that data in detail. So if it all turns green, it's all good to go, right? So it's done all the validation, sees that these are good. If that bin already exists, it's going to turn red and say, well, this bin actually exists already and I can remove it from the grid and so on. So it does all the basic validation. If I click the update button again, off it goes and it actually writes these bins directly into the Datascope tables, right? So there we go, we've created a whole new bin. So I'm doing it with 4, but the reality I could be importing literally thousands of bins directly into the database. So this is particularly good for us internally with brand new sites. Okay, so and then I want to just show you using the same screen again, but this time I want to take a range of bins. So I want to go and fetch, just a range of bins. Let's go and find any range, perhaps from there to down here somewhere. Select that, I load it to the grid. And what I want to do is I want to do some bulk updates of the data, right? So on this particular range of bins, the area code is incorrect. The volume is not set, the maximum mass is not set, and I want to fix that. So I can go to the update tab. Again, I can say, let's go to the first one here. What did we say? We're going to change area. So let's go and find area here somewhere. There it is there. So I say I want to set the area to area A. I want to send the maximum mass to 800 kilograms. That's all I want to put in there. And I want to put the volume, I think we said. We want to set that to 3,000 cubic inches or whatever the case is. And let's maybe also update the zone. We want to put the zone to zone B across the board. Okay, there's a couple of other things I can do. I can actually change the warehouse here. Okay, so I could actually go and take a range of bins and actually select a different warehouse. And that often is quite useful if you have a particular row of product. If you look at your warehouse is split into two different warehouses, and there's one row that you want the one warehouse to be bigger and the other one to be smaller. So now I want to take that row, get that range of bins and update them into the other warehouse, okay? And there's quite a bit of logic in the background there that it will actually find the stock that's there and will move it in the background into the warehouse. So it will reallocate that bin to a new warehouse as well as move all the inventory across, okay? So let me run that update. You can see there again, it does the validation, all's gone green, so I'm happy with that. It's obviously setting the volume to 3,000, the max to 800. It set the area and the zone, and if I click update again, that commits it to the database. So very simply and easily, I can actually go and do bulk updates and clean up my data, to link bins to correct areas and zones and maximum number of pallets, et cetera, et cetera. So that's on that side. I'm going to move on and we'll do questions after this session. The second one that we've done is what we call track ID creation advanced. So we have this ability to create new track IDs or new license plates within the software that's been around forever. The advanced screen basically takes it a step further. There are some cases where somebody does transactions directly into SysPro for whatever reason. So sometimes there's very specific, on a purchase receipts, there's very, very specific apportionment of costs, etc. The client, for whatever reason, doesn't want to do it inside our software. They want to do it in SysPro because it must be done by the costing and purchasing department. And the net result is they're going to do a receipt in SysPro that's going to put stock into a specific bin into SysPro. And then we want to take control of that stock, create a license plate or track ID or number of them, and then control it from there on. So very simply, what the screen allows me to do is to enter a bin location. Let me just, I'm not sure why it's hanging there. Let's just get back there quickly. RECVFG. So this is the bin I want to look at, okay? And what this thing's basically doing is, did I type it wrong?
Yeah, you typed REVC.
Yeah, I'm dyslexic, you see. All right, so what it does then is it actually runs what we would call the balance report, okay? So it goes and looks at this bin. It says, I can find all the stock in SysPro. I can find all these tracking IDs in Datascope that match up. But I find this stock in SysPro that isn't in Datascope yet. So you need to deal with this, right? And then basically straight from here, I can create what we call a master track ID. So if I simply print a master track ID, I can direct that to a particular printer, and that will create like a master tracking ID, which I can then use to go and put away and maybe do some palletization to break it up onto multiple pallets and take it away. Okay, So I'm not going to go further than that. I mean, that's basically what this thing does. But I want to touch on one other thing that is quite a nice, also a very neat feature for brand new warehouses that are going to go live. Okay, so we have quite a number of sites, particularly big distribution centers, where they are currently running on SysPro. They have multiple bins turned on in SysPro. They do already have the records in SysPro that says this bin has this particular stock, right? And when we're coming from a brand new implementation for that particular warehouse, obviously we have no tracking IDs or license plates for the inventory in those bins. Now, what we can basically do is we can use this import button, okay, to actually import a long list, common eliminated list of all the bin locations that SysPro knows about that we have not got track IDs for, okay? So I can take that whole warehouse, I can take the bin state from SysPro, put it in a common eliminated file, import it here, okay? It will run the query here, and obviously if it's a brand new warehouse, we'll have none of that stock on our side. But basically this data would be a very long list of data with every single SysPro bin location and what is inside that bin location as per SysPro, bin by bin in this particular screen. So you'll have multiple bins down the side here. And if I click this master tracking ID, what it's going to do is the software is immediately going to move through each bin and it's going to create one track ID or one license plate for every single bin all the way down. So we used this at IPC when we went live there. It worked extremely well. So obviously for any brand new implementation, we need to have every pallet labeled as part of the initial stock count or inventory count. This way I can actually, as long as SysPro has the data, I can actually query that out and create all of those labels on the fly per rack. So I could import the list by aisle as an example. I can put in logic in the background here to print them in bin sequence number. So the software will basically print them in sequence of R. And at the start of the start count, I give a role to someone. I say, you go count R A. And he's going to move down the aisle, and you'll have a label, a pallet label, for each pallet as he counts it all the way through. So just a nice feature if you're expanding to a new warehouse or if it's a brand new implementation, that function allows us, just in RPC as an example, we created 13,000 new pallet track IDs or license plates as we started the initial stock count for go live. So yeah, just wanted to share that with you. And then let's go back to Stephen if you're ready.
Yep, 100%. Sorry, my problem was my emulator wasn't connected. Okay, so just to remind you on the scenario, we had the put-away screen and the user was a bit frustrated that he couldn't see his description and he didn't want to see these two fields for PFBin and the site's not lot traceable, so they don't want to see the lot number. So what we've got is I've opened up the SQL on the left-hand side. It's just a database table that holds the standard field lengths for all of the screens. So this has been rolled out throughout the entire scanner application. You can manipulate the field sizes on any of the grids. So if we have a look here, that's the standard screen I've got open. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna change a couple of things here. I'm gonna make the description a bit bigger and I'm gonna take the lot numbers out. I'm gonna take the PF bin out and the stock code we're happy with. So once I've done that, as soon as I exit the screen and go back in, it affects the screens immediately. So you can see the screen looks much better now. We can see the full description and the stock code. This might seem like a very small thing, but we've had a couple of customers where their stock codes have got just a little bit too long. So what we can do with this is across the entire scanner screen, anywhere the stock code is visible, we can just increase that size a little bit. And also if you're not lot traceable, you can go to all your screens and just remove all the lot number columns, giving you a little bit more real estate for the rest of your fields. So, just a little bit of customization on the existing application.
Okay, Stephen, just before we move on to Amy's slides, are there any questions at the moment on those three things that we've just seen?
Yeah.
The last one that you just showed, from which version of WMS will that be available?
Okay, so this is available in version 5.03.
Yeah.
It's a relatively new change. We put it in literally in the last 2 months, but that version has been rolled over and so it is available, yeah.
Just one question that came through earlier, or a statement regarding the CKS65 and the ability to move it from Windows platform to Android. In the North American market, you can buy that device and with a standard option to pay $100, send the device back into Intermac, and for $100 per device, they'll convert it for you and send it back to you. So just to be clear on that one.
I also had a question online from a bit earlier, just a comment saying that on the tablet, on the truck loading example, it said maybe it's a bit far-fetched. But if you're using a tablet during the truck loading, based on the condition of the goods, you could take a picture with your tablet and upload that to a database and link it up to your shipment. So yes, you could do that too. Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't realize I was muted. So I'm going to talk through a couple of new screens in the standard software. The first one that I want to introduce is the new on-hold functionality, and how I'm going to explain how we arrived at this is working through a couple of scenarios. So when we looked at a couple of our sites, we saw that there were three sort of distinct categories of reasons why people were putting stuff on hold. And a large one that kept coming up was around customer service. So an example here is that a customer puts in a huge order and it's only going to come through in a month or something like that. Or you know that a store is going to open, they're going to be putting in a big order, so you want to sort of hold back some stock. And the only way to do that is by putting stock on hold or creating a sales order, and yet there's no sales order to reserve stock. So well, that was definitely something that we saw. And the problem here is that CISPRO would put the entire lot or the entire stock code on hold, which means you can't move the stock, you can't pick it for anybody else. So that was one thing that we saw. Also, CISPRO, if we put it on hold, it wasn't visible to the users on the floor. So we needed to sort of tick those two boxes. Sorry, I'm trying to get my thing to tab. Sorry, secondly, this also needed to be linked to a new permission so that you couldn't have then the inventory team go and use this stock. So if the existing customer service team put some stock on hold, then the inventory team shouldn't be allowed to take it off hold and use it for something else. And speaking of the inventory team, the challenges that they were facing, the reasons that they were putting stock on hold was around stock that's maybe blocked or unreachable. You can't get to it, you can't pick it. There was discontinued product, or maybe a newer product range came in and you wanted to encourage the older product to be picked first and sent out the warehouse. Again, there were limitations within CISPRO here to only put the entire stock code on hold or the lot on hold when you only wanted to segregate certain pallets and put those on hold. Again, a permission would be required so that the customer service team doesn't come and take that off hold and use that for sales. Lastly, the last sort of category is quality assurance, where we were finding that people were using it after it's come through the quality module, the stock's all been put away and suddenly there's a recall or something else has failed that took, let's say, a microbial testing that took a couple of days, or for expiry date extensions, damaged stock, or incorrect documentation or packaging. So again, we needed another permission. So what we've done is created three different on-hold groups that ships with the software. So there are three groups, being the customer service, inventory, and quality assurance. And then it's up to you to decide the reasons. So under customer service, you could put as many reasons as you like. My examples here are Walmart and Costco. And that would allow you to customize why you are putting the stock on hold. That reason is the one that's visible then in an information check. And you can then customize inventory reasons and quality assurance reasons as well. So sort of to recap, it's more granular control than CISPRO. The user can specify the on-hold reasons. And again, there are different permissions. So the customer service group would have a different permission to the inventory group and a different permission to the quality assurance group. So nobody kind of steps on each other's toes. And last but not least, really beneficial is multiple track IDs can be updated simultaneously. So I'm going to walk you through that now and then ask for questions. Sorry. So the on-hold module is actually under a couple of different folders. It's also under order release and under the quality banner as well, but I've opened it up here under the normal warehouse setup. So you can set up your reasons under a little screen here, much like cycle count reasons. You can set up your different groups and the different reasons that you want to be putting stock on hold. And then we have, much like the bin maintenance and tracker creation advanced screens like Anton was showing you, we have a sort of a bunch of filters here that you can tee up a grid of stuff that you want to be working with and then update it. So if I look here, I'm going to go and have a look for some stock codes. Sorry, I'm not going to say single. I'm going to get a list going here. And let's take those three. I'm going to be patient here. Okay, so you can see here, I've just said, go and find me all the stock codes for A100, A101 and A103. And you can see already I've got some stuff on hold here, but then quite easily I can go and say, oh yes, that pallet, that's the one that's damaged or broken or whatever. Those three, I want to go and update those. And bearing in mind that I have the permission for everything here, I could say, though it's been discontinued, and then update. And it would update it. In the same way, I can say remove from hold, and it will filter this by only by the pallets, which I've got. Now it's dropped all my filters, obviously, but these are all the reasons that I've got on hold, all the pallets that I've got on hold. So any questions on hold before I go into?
Go on here, Amy.
Yeah.
So what's the effect if the stock, the pallet is on hold?
Yeah.
That's being toxic. What's the effect? Can you count an on hold pallet?
Yes, yeah. You can count, you can stock take an on hold pallet because it's still in stock in CISPRO, right? So you definitely must count it. You can cycle count it, you can expense issue it, and if you've got a certain permission, you can SET it. So you can pick it for an SET, pick and reserve SET stock codes, because then in theory, you're just transferring it from one warehouse to another, you're not actually selling it. There's quite a few benefits for using that.
Just Just one scenario that's come up very often is a lot of distribution centers want to allocate certain amount of inventory to certain customers. So I know ESCO, for instance, you asked about this once in the past. If I get a batch of a certain perfume in and I get, let's say, 10,000 bottles, how can I make sure that I give those 10,000 bottles, I break it up into 2,000 units per customer? So this is a different way of doing it. One could actually then take that inventory once it's in your warehouse and actually go and put it on hold for different reason codes. So you could go and say, take the 10,000, take the first 2,000, which is 3 pallets worth, take those 3 pallets, put them on hold for customer A, take the rest, put them on hold for customer B, et cetera, et cetera. And then the reservation rule obviously will not reserve or pick or move that stock. You cannot pick or sell it because they're on hold. But your sales team would have the ability then to control that, your customer service guys, to actually go in there when they want to, unhold the stock, reserve it for a particular order and send it up. So you know, there's many ways of using this. It's just, it's a really nice tool and it's a lot more user-friendly than what Cispro would be. Cispro's too high level in terms of locking everything or unlocking everything. This allows you to control it for different reasons and by different people.
Okay, I've got two more questions I can see on the from the attendees. And the one is, will the SO and job allocation routines be able to consider the different on-hold groups separately? Since this is stored at the pallet level on the sort of pallet header record, definitely you would be able to read that quite easily and take that into consideration so that you could see that, it's a Walmart order you're reserving. So in theory, you could reserve that stock, yeah, or automatically activate it.
Yeah, so just can I touch on that as well? I mean, in your custom rule, remember your reservation rule is a custom rule, right? So as long as you build your own custom rule, you can add into your reservation rule whatever rules you want. So you could say in your reservation rule that if the customer happens to be Walmart and I find stock that is on hold for Walmart, reserve it anyway.
The next question is from, how does Cispro see the stock set on hold in WMS? I.e., is it still seen as being available? Yes, it is available in Cispro because we can't put a certain quantity on hold in Cispro only. So the biggest problem here is that, say, Cispro has multiple bins available of the stock or 3,000 available, and we only want to put 100 on hold. We can't do that in Cispro. So Cispro needs to see the stock as totally available, and the control has to sit with the data scope. Okay, so if there's nothing else, I'm going to move on to when this screen wants to listen to me.
Hey, Amy, there's one more. Sorry, Amy.
Sorry.
Can you create a panel on Cisco to show that these items are
for sure?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, that's a great idea because it's sitting on the pallet header.
Sorry, Amy, can you repeat the question because we couldn't hear it?
Oh, sorry. They were saying, could you bring a panel through to Cispro to be able to show which are on hold? So currently, the existing panels, some people have the module here to pull in a custom pane, and those already show panel how much inventory is on hold on the inventory panel. But there's no reason why that couldn't be improved to show which reasons those pallets are on hold for and drill down to the total quantities there. Happy? Shall I go on?
That's fine, thanks.
Okay. So the next thing I'm not going to demo, but I'm just going to talk through, and that's around, it's a very small thing, but really, really powerful because it's around permissions on the sales order release screen. So currently anybody who's got permission to the screen can reserve stock, manually reserve, or confirm, or clear reservations. So it's quite wide open. Whereas if we add permissions to these buttons, like a different permission for clear reservations. Only certain people can clear reservations. Only certain people can auto reserve. Only certain people can manually reserve, and only certain people can confirm. Means that we can control the flow of the orders to the warehouse. So, for example, sales could be in charge of auto reserving stock. So they can make a reliable promise to a customer and say, yes, I've auto reserved. I can see your fill rate is 99%. Your fill rate is 50%. I'm going to give you the stock. but they don't need to push the confirm button. They don't need to send it to the warehouse floor because we don't need that paper printed there and then. The warehouse can tee up what load is going to hit the warehouse for the day, what shipment it's going to go on, which carrier it's going to go to, and really organize their planning of the day better based on the workload that comes through from the sales order entry people or the customer service people. It also means that we can prevent manual reservations. If you've got a really custom rule that's looking at expiry dates and special rules on stock codes based on certain ingredients, I know this gets more and more hairy as we get into more in-depth pharma sites, then we don't want people going clicking manual reserve and overriding what the software and the rule has specifically selected for that order. So that's those are all different permissions. You'll see them pop up in the later versions. Any questions on that?
There's one here.
Ali, from which version are these permissions active in the software?
What version are they available in?
502 or 501 up. 501, 502. I can check for you.
It's quite a far way back, yeah. It's done a while back.
Yeah. Sorry, now I have to put focus on my slide every time. I'm not getting that right. The next one I want to talk through very quickly is job issues and job returns. Reason notation, this is brand new. This is sitting in 503. And it allows us to give a reason code for why we are either issuing to a job or returning from a job. Sort of the examples to what you would want to record when you job issue would be which machine you're issuing it from. Maybe you're replacing a stock code and want to record that. Sort of the sky's the limit there. Again, it's a setup option in the core software on your PC to say, these are the reason codes, much like I showed you for the on-hold reasons. It's totally free form text for you to decide. And then sort of job return reason codes, I was thinking, you know, maybe you've over-issued to the job. Maybe you're going to produce the job short, or maybe there's a quality defect on the raw material that you've issued to the job and you want to take it off and issue another lot. So the reasons that you, once this transaction is posted, both on job issue and job return, those reasons are recorded in TrackID history, and they're posted to the CISPRO journal notation field, which should come up in a little screenshot here. So you can see here, I did a job return, and these were the reasons that I did it for, and here is it sitting in the notation in CISPRO. So the last thing on the standard software to discuss, I think a lot of people have been waiting for, is the advanced cycle count scheduler, which should come out pretty soon. It's sort of going into QA this week. So I'm going to show you the PC screen and not the scanner screen because that's still sitting in QA, but here's a screenshot of it and I'll talk you through now. So the key feature for this advanced cycle count scheduler is the count entity, so the level at which you'll count. Our existing cycle count scheduler allowed you only to select a bin level. So you could only say, I want to schedule this range of bins or these five bins for counting. It didn't allow you to say, I want to count this stock code across the warehouse. And we've changed that. So now you can decide, I want to count this bin, this range of bins, this aisle, this zone, whatever you want to say, this stock code, or this lot number. We have a PC screen, which I'll show you just now, which allows you sort of to tee up counts. So much in the same way as the bin maintenance screen, a lot of our screens are changing to that look and feel because it's a lot easier to deal with all your parameters and review a grid of data before you commit to doing something. So this, I'm going to show you the PC screen now, allows us to tee up the counts, select which stock codes we want to count, which bins, which lot numbers, but then there's a lot more filters which we'll look at, like product class, ABC costing, that sort of thing. So you tee up the SM and account this range of stock codes and push to a schedule. And this also allows you to decide not only what will be counted, but when it should be counted by. And there's a bit more sophisticated scheduling there, which I'll show you. The critical point here is that the details to the on which track IDs to count will be populated as the user on the scanner begins the count. So let's say you have set up a count for a certain stock code, A100. We can't list off which track IDs for A100 should be counted right now because that could change tomorrow, in 2 seconds, next week. We don't know when the user is going to start counting it. So what happens is as the user begins the count on the scanner, we fetch the track IDs there and then that have A100 and list those for him to count. The same goes for lot number and actually for bin. We'll say, right, you were told to count bin 01A, 01A, and at that time, that's when we query, okay, these are the track IDs, these are the stock codes in that bin. So it's much more real-time direction. So there's the question, what track IDs have A100 on it? The HTML5 scanner screen is the only screen that will be holding this software, and it will allow us to limit the number of lines to count per user. So you'll be able to prevent one user having to count all of the A100 palettes. So if you've got 1,000 palettes, we can say, okay, no, only every user is only allowed 30 counts. So he selects the first the schedule, it would load 30 counts for him. Then the next user gets another 30, next another 30, another 30. So you can all count A100 simultaneously, but obviously they're directed to different palettes. And they would be directed to each palette and bin in a more of a picking fashion. So you can see the screenshot here. It looks much like our existing picking screen and the HTML5 picking screen, where you suggested a bin, a track ID, and a stock code, and a lot number if you are counting at a lot level. And then you have to count that stock and the quantity and optionally enter reason. The last point is that you can review progress instantaneously, and you'll see that now on the PC screen. So I'll give you a quick look at that. So if I come down to stock taken cycle counting, cycle count schedule advanced is where it's sitting. Now this may take a little bit of time to load because I've got a lot of data in here. You can see it's got the exact sort of setup as our other screens. So you can either look by bin or by stock code, lots, or we can review the scheduled counts. So if I go into stock codes and I say, well, I want to count all stock codes with an ABC class of A and B, and I load those to the grid. So here I'm teeing up, what do I want to count? Okay, the only stock codes that's returned, because this is my data, is B100 and B200. Okay, now I say, right, I know I want to count those. What I need to allocate a count date. Do I want to do this daily? Do I want it weekly? And I can choose a day of the week. And then I can choose the number of counts to be done per day. This count is related to the count entity. So if I'm saying one count per day here, it's one stock code per day. If I was saying two, it'd be two stock codes per day, because obviously we don't know how many palettes there will be until that time. So I give it a date. Sorry, let me scroll across here. So it's given me a count due date. I've just missed that field. Sorry, that's me adding it. Add to schedule. There we go. Now we go to have a look at the scheduled counts. And if I click load to grid, this could take a little while because I've got a lot. There we go. You can see that here I can review progress instantaneously. So the counts that I've just added would be sitting at the bottom here, B100 and B200. And then you can see I've got a whole lot of other new counts that are waiting to be done with certain due dates. I can change the due date on a count at any time unless the count has been started. So here I've got counts in progress, and those don't have a count due date option to change. If they're overdue, they go red. So at any point here, I could see, let's say for stock code, where's my stock code one? I could look at the stock code, and then I can view the status of different counts. And obviously I can use all these filters down the side to say, well, which dates am I looking at? Which warehouses, which bins, maybe which operators are counting, see how they're doing. This all then posts, the counting screen posts right back to the normal cycle count screen that you're used to. So that all that functionality remains in place to review your counts and accept them. But here we're recording who's counting and at exactly what time they've counted. So any questions on, I think I forgot to ask questions on job material issue and cycle count scheduler.
Yeah,